and talking ad lib, reminiscing in a way I think you'll find very intimate and personal. It's just him to you. It's not a concert, and there's no audience. And there are no sidemen. You don't see Johnny Hodges or Cootie Williams or Harry Carney. It's just Duke Ellington, or Edward Kennedy Ellington, as he was named in 1899 in Washington, D.C. You know, he actually played in this very studio at the ABC for a one-hour special when he first visited Australia with his band in February 1970. He was 71 years old then. He's an extraordinary man, a great musician, and of course, part of the fabric of American culture. He said some wonderful, quotable things. One that I love was about the pouches under his eyes. He said to a journalist once, "Don't look at my bags that way. They're an accumulation of virtue." He came out with a lot of gems like that. And tonight he talks about what is jazz. He says jazz is a tree. Just listen to his analogy. I love jazz, especially Duke Ellington, because it's so happy, peaceful, and sociable. So sit back with a drink and a little something to eat and enjoy the Duke.
Hi, that's La Fleur Africaine, little African flower. I am Duke Ellington, and I'm now in Paris discussing a very, very provocative subject, sometimes known as jazz. It's jazz, and I suppose I should claim a membership or a license, because the way I improvised that first number proves that I have a license. It's not like the original version, precisely. I should like to go into possibly another explanation, or one of the twists and turns that we take in sort of copping out in jazz. Let's take Billy Strayhorn's Take the A Train, our theme. I think probably that ending is sort of like the discussion about jazz. Jazz is a never-ending discussion. We have all sorts of thoughts about it from various people, some who know quite a bit about it and some who like to listen to it, and others who are rather annoyed by it. And so it gives many, many points of view. And the discussion is never finished. It's a very important subject. When I was in Africa, in Senegal, I met Papa Tal, a great Senegalese artist. And I was sort of giving him a theme on jazz, because it's a constant question. What is jazz? What is jazz? And there's so many things. And I was busy ad-libbing this sort of extravagant picture of jazz, and I said, jazz is a tree, and it has many, many branches that reach out into many directions. Of course, it goes into the Far East and picks up an exotic blossom. At the end of each branch is a twig, and at the end of each twig there are many different shaped leaves and many vari-colored flowers, and it goes east, west, north, south, and everywhere. And everywhere it goes, it picks up some certain influence. And if you go back to the trunk, you'll find that it's probably a sort of transparent bark, we could say, even made in Japan. And as he goes down into the deep roots that go way down into the earth, then you'll find out that these blue-blooded black roots are deep in the soil of black Africa, which of course is the foundation of everything that is with the beat. The beat that of course today is the most listened to in the world. And jazz has many licenses, as I said before. The 2-4, the 3-4, the 4-4, and even the 5-4. There have been many, many great people in it. And then, of course, it not only gets highly mathematical, but it sometimes gets very romantic. I mean, for instance, Johnny Hodges was one of the great purveyors of the romantic and very soul-searching sounds that had the sort of pastel veneer of compulsion to that. I've heard, like when he did the Warm Valley. Things ain't what they used to be. And let's see now what. Of course, every time I come to Paris, I'm a little, extremely concerned about what to play, and of course, to what to say. Of course, that's something else again. And of course, there's so many interesting things and so many interesting people that I would need a much longer time to actually discuss it in detail. I mean, I should think we would start with two of the citizens of Paris. One was Django Reinhardt, who was a very dear friend of mine. I had him with us in the United States on a concert tour, so much so that, we didn't even have him billed because I was so eager to have him there so I could enjoy him. Very selfish thing indeed. And then, of course, there's Sidney Bechet, who worked with us in 1926. Incidentally, we did a portrait of Sidney Bechet in a new album that's coming out sometime soon, and I don't think I remember it good enough to play it. And what do we do about that? What do we play that? We would say, do something? I say, no, I can't. It seems that I've always had rather good luck in Paris and with people who are from Paris. For instance, the first time I conducted with Baton was when I conducted the personal appearance of the inimitable Maurice Chevalier in New York City at the Fulton Theater. And then I was here for 8 weeks doing Paris Blues. Paris Blues went something like that. Doing Paris Blues, I also was honored by being invited to the cathedral. And it wasn't the cathedral, it was Christmas Eve night and the big Christmas Eve Mass at the Palais de Défense. And I was allowed to play Come Sunday there, which I thought was a great honor. Come Sunday. And Come Sunday is a spiritual theme from Black, Brown, and Beige. I think this was one of the significant things that we did, which attracted the attention of the clergy and the dedicated people of the church to invite us to do sacred concerts, which we started in September 1965. Strayhorn loved Paris, and it was one of his favorite places. And of course, I loved Strayhorn because Strayhorn and I got so close that when I did my first sacred concert, he was sick in the hospital, and I was in California, he was in New York, and I called him. I said, "Strays, I'm doing, the theme is the first four words in the Bible, in the beginning, God. And I'd like for you to do either an interlude, an introduction or something, you know, to keep him busy. And just do it, you know," and then tell him what it went like. And his theme had six syllables or six tones, and mine had six syllables and six tones, naturally, in the beginning, God. And there were only two notes that were different. Now, I don't remember which of his notes were different, but this is the... His started in the same place and ended in the same place, and only two of the notes in between were different. So it was a very, very close thing. Billy Strayhorn, he wrote Lotus Blossom, and he always said that I played it better than he, you know. He was a very gracious man, you know. Bridges plays it better than I do. Oh, someone asked for Black Beauty. Yeah, that's it. Thank you. Black Beauty, written in 1928, before black was beautiful. I'd like now to, discuss some of the other opportunities I've had here in Paris. Mr. Jean Villard of the TNP invited me to come over and do the music for Tucaré, a French classic that had not been performed since 1709. And of course that was a ball to be able to work with such fine artists. And of course I recorded that with the French under the Paris band. And I thought it was great. And sometimes I suppose we'll release that. Well, shall I do a little of New World of Coming now? Well, I can't do a little of it. Either I have to do all of it or nothing. And so, New World Coming, incidentally, is one of the instrumentals we did in the our first sacred concert, which means New World Coming, is a place in the distant future on land, at sea, or in the air, where there will be no war, no greed, no non-believers, no categorization, and where love is unconditional and there is no pronoun good enough for God. a satin doll. You know what a satin doll is. A satin doll is a beauty with utility. And beauty with utility. This sort of brings us to a question that we often ask. They say, well, which do you prefer, to work into the nightclubs, or to work for dances, or the concert hall, or the old house rent parties, or what? Well, actually, to me, it doesn't make any difference where I play, and the most important thing, no matter where I play, is that we have an audience there who think enough of us to not only come and listen, but they are investing their time in it. And, of course, nobody has anything more valuable than time, which is very important. And then I have a request to play Dances in Love. Dances in Love is a little bit of an icky tune, which we did back in 1947, I think it was. And it's about the middle, of course, it's played by the piano player. And about the middle, there are breaks in the melody, and the gentlemen of the orchestra, as you see the pictures around here, usually fill these breaks by snapping their fingers. One, two, three. And so you, ladies and gentlemen, are all cordially invited to join also and snap your fingers. One, two, three. Dances in Love. I'll tell you when. This one. Yes. Take a bow. Bon, 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 bon. Merci. Je vous aime à la folie. You see that, don't you? You hear that?
Duke Ellington, who read a book called Music is My Mistress, and how kind she was to him. Over 5,000 compositions in his lifetime, including hits like Sophisticated Lady and Satin Doll. A great talent for running a band, a great talent for encouraging others and finding other talent. Edward Kennedy Ellington, the Duke. And still to come in this Jazz and Blues Night on ABC television, Billie Holiday's story in Long Night of Lady Day, the Glenn Miller Memorial Concert, Shelley Mann, music in Monk Time, Thelonious Monk, who else, and some classic blues, jazz, and boogie with Blind John Davis.
Hello. The next part of our Jazz and Blues weekend is devoted to the singer Billie Holiday. quite simply, the greatest jazz singer of all time. I fell in love with the music when I first fell in love with jazz in my early teens. Billie Holiday stands alone among jazz singers, both for her style and for her expressiveness. I believe she's the only singer who can be ranked with the very greatest of the jazz instrumentalists of her period. That's from the mid-30s to the late 50s. Her life, and the life of much of America, was poured out in her music. What a life it was. On the one hand, hopeless tragedy. On the other, supreme triumph. In order to deal with Billie Holiday, one must deal with the paradox of someone who never compromised her musical integrity, but lived a life of misery and degradation. This film, The Long Night of Lady Day, assembles the most complete selection yet of her film and television appearances. It was made in late 1983, early 1984, and sets out to be the definitive retrospective of her life. I'll conclude this introduction by quoting her last accompanist, Mal Waldron, who said, "Lady sang as she spoke, with no reservations. Hers were pointed, moving sermons from the text of life. Always spontaneous, always creative. She wouldn't have it any other way."
There was such a quietness over these musicians, such a multitude of them there, and we just stood around like in awe, and we filed out of the church and stood on the corners for a few minutes until everybody got out, and we just quieted, just stealthed away into the crowd. There was not the usual thing of a musician going to a bar after a guy's gone and having a drink or a type of New Orleans festivities. It was just dead quiet and sadness.
Gloomy Sunday, with shadows I spend it all. My heart and I have decided to end it all. Soon there'll be candles and that I know. Let them not weep, let them know that I'm glad to go. Death is no dream, for in death I'm caressing you with the last breath of my soul. I'll be blessing you.
On July 17th, 1959, the greatest of all the jazz singers, Billie Holiday, died. 4 days later, in this church in New York City, her funeral was held. Billie fascinates me because she was a Catholic, and I am a Catholic priest. There's a strange connection between the very seductive world of nightlife and jazz and the sort of life that a certain kind of Catholicism can propel you toward. She was caught or trapped between two opposites, filled with a kind of joy for living, and on the other hand, tortured and disturbed. Lady Day's story begins in Baltimore, Maryland in 1915. Baltimore is and was a very Catholic city, the state of Maryland named after Mary, the Virgin Mother, and the place where Catholics first came to the United States. Several really severe things happened to her during those first 10 years in Baltimore that might explain something of her later self-destruction. Where all the joy came from, that's more mysterious to me. The first incident, Billy was lying in the arms of her grandmother and fell asleep. The grandmother died, and when Billy awoke, the grandmother's arms were locked around her. This terrified her. Sometime later, when she was nothing more than a child of 10, a little girl, she was raped by a man 40 years of age, and by a terrible reversal, she was punished for this. And the judge remanded her to a Catholic institution for girls where she was cared for or kept by nuns. For some infraction or other, Billy was locked in a room overnight where a dead girl was laid out in a coffin. She writes that she beat her hands to a bloody pulp. Some terrifying things for a little girl of no more than 10 to try to comprehend.
Was I born? Why am I living? What do I get? What am I giving? Why do I want for things I dare not hope for? What can I hope for? I wish I knew.
Poor Alice, thank you for loving me. Lady Day, Billie Holiday. Well, at the time, I didn't really understand why she would write something like that to me. But as I got to know her later, I think she just had a need for being loved, and she obviously, in her life up to that point, obviously hadn't really felt loved, or not loved in the sense that she wanted to be. She told me that her mother and father never married, and her father really, I don't think, spent that much time, except maybe in her very early life, at home. He was a traveling musician. I think she definitely needed somebody to advise her and look after her. She said when she was a very young child, she had decided that she wasn't going to be anybody's damn maid, is the way she expressed it. And she fought against this, I think, all her life. At one time, she did help her mother in her job as a maid, and she, of course, cleaned the steps as a child in Baltimore. But the opportunities for black women at her time were not too many for someone without more than a fifth grade education, which is all she said she ever had. She also had listened to music in the bordellos in Baltimore, and she liked music there better than she liked it in church, she said. So that was her alternative, was to become a prostitute. And she was quite young when she came to New York and started to work up in Harlem.
Who will buy? Who would like to sample my supply? Who's prepared to pay the price for a trip to paradise? Love for sale.
Thank you.
When I first met Billy, she had already been in jail 2 or 3 times for prostitution. And she was just recently out. Billy didn't have a terribly satisfactory sexual life, unfortunately. And I guess that may have come from those early days, you know, working in whorehouses and loathing the kind of treatment that she got there.
She didn't make her living as a singer. She just started making the rounds trying to find a job somewhere as a dancer. And you probably remember the story that she applied for a job as a dancer at some club, and the owner was not very impressed, but he took pity on her and said, can you do anything else? Can you sing? So then she sang one number. I was traveling all alone, and that was the beginning of her singing career.
About that time, I discovered Harlem, and I used to go up there almost every night and sit in a little joint called Pods and Jerry's, where Willie the Lion Smith used to play. And I was just sitting in as a, you know, an honored guest or a dishonored guest, and some little gal walked in there, and somebody said, hey, Billy, why don't you sing some blues? And she got up and sang some blues. And she had a sense of time and a sense of authentic phrasing that was, you know, it was jazz in the best sense of the word. And later I said, who's that kid? And somebody said, oh, her name is Billie Holiday. She works around here. And Willie said, trouble is she drinks too much and she gets fired from a lot of jobs. But she can sing.
She could take a tawdry tune and do it, turn it around 40 different ways, which she used to have to do in the nightclubs because, you know, she'd sing to tables, particularly in speakeasies, you see. There was no sound system in speakeasies because that might get out into the street. So she would sing very quietly at various tables and sing the same tune differently at each table. It was just an unbelievable feat, you know. It just came absolutely natural to Billy. I never heard another singer who could do it this way. By this time, I had gotten Billy at least in association with Brunswick Records and Vocalion Records, and she could go into the studio anytime.
The first record I made, I was about